With this, I would like now to, with pleasure, to introduce Miss Leila Connors, which takes us to another, for me, very important area of activity. She is a filmmaker, a documentary maker. She's also a writer. She has created a group, I mean, the Tree Media Group, to carry on her interests, her concerns. Out of that came a first important documentary called The 11th Hour, where she interviewed 54 leading thinkers, and including scientists, on the state of the world and the human condition. Later on, together with Leonardo DiCaprio as a producer, she directed a very important documentary called Ice on Fire, where focusing the climate change goes into showing us specific existing solutions and specific practices being moved forward. And now she's working in a new project with the difficulties of the COVID to move around and to be shooting. The title of the project is Into Eden, and it's about how we can change our society and ourselves on the face of the forces that threaten everything from the biosphere to our economic system. So while we were working to invite Leila to participate with an accent on the inspiring actions component of our endeavor.
Well, thank you, Ricardo, and thank you, UNESCO. Actually, I went to school in Paris, and I lived across the street from UNESCO, so I remember it well. I founded Tree Media. Actually, I have a background in international politics and economics and was in think tanks for a while when I realized that the story is the most important thing to move society in the direction that we need. And this is why I like this panel very much. So thank you for having the vision to discuss this in depth and come up with solutions. I'll just, as you know, I'm speaking from my experience. I feel like I've been in the trenches of something I call the story machine. The story machine is created by entrenched interests that Astrid discussed. Basically, it comes down to a barrage of information, false information and money that is supported by the story machine. It's an ecosystem of interests that control access to information in the world. So the good work of scientists, which I work with them to tell these stories, we're up against this, like what I call the Death Star, and we're like the Rebel Alliance, that are little ships that are trying to get into this giant edifice of information. Now one would think, and I was very naive when I first did The 11th Hour with Leo the first time around, we thought, wow, when we tell everybody what's going on, then everything's going to change and everyone's going to go, oh, okay, this is what's happening and we're all going to change. Well, we found out that that's not what happens. What happens is it gets suppressed and sequestered. One of my anecdotes is that in Cannes, we went the first time around, interestingly, the French and the Europeans are very supportive of our work. And they gave us a big platform in Cannes to bring out both our movies. The first time they thought that, just because it's a science doc, maybe no one would show up in the press. So they gave us a small room, not because they were mean, it's just because they thought maybe no one would show up. Well, we ended up getting 300 international journalists, and they had to book a giant theater to do our press conference. So we thought, wow, we're doing this, it's great, it's amazing. And then one of these guys who's paid by the Koch network or whoever they're paid by from Fox News or Sky was in the front row, and he asked about how Leo gets around. And Leo doesn't, he's very modest, actually, given what his options are. And anyway, long story short, the only thing that left the room was all about Leo and nothing about climate change. So basically, that's what happens. That was the diversion meeting the fix or whatever. No, not the fix, meeting the screen or whatever. So anyway, I loved, Astrid, what you were saying. I've encountered almost every element of those five different things. And so not, needless to say, not to be deterred, I tried to figure out how to get around the story machine and how to do this. And this is what you're talking about. I don't really tend to call it fake information because of course that exists. What you're dealing with is a much larger edifice underneath the fake information. This is entrenched interests that have no interest in changing. It's how they make their money. And they feed each other. So, you know, the major networks, for example, have you ever wondered why when they talk about the weather, they never talk about climate? I mean, that's a very, you know, the Weather Channel started to do it. There have been a few, you know, weather people that, you know, talk about climate, but they don't because they're not allowed to. So that's what we're dealing with. I think you guys all know that. But, you know, again, what I'd like to say also is I think things are starting to work. Sadly, they're working a little bit too late. We have the tools and the knowledge. You know, we know what to do. It's really about getting around the algorithms on social media. Now, for example, I tried to post stuff on climate very recently on Facebook, and they wouldn't let me boost a post about planting trees because they said it was political. Okay, so we're getting a suppression of the information because these interests, I think, are seeing that change is coming and they're becoming more blatant into the suppression of the information. They've actually been very sneaky. You know, not a lot of us knew that they were actively suppressing until the Exxon papers came out. Maybe scientists knew. I mean, I've talked to a lot of scientists like Michael Mann, for example, who has been excoriated by, the Blitz has really taken out a lot of scientists. And so, and even me, so when I wanted to talk, so Leonardo came to me to talk about methane 8 years ago. And we were suppressed by not just, self-edited, let's say, in the sense, because all of the scientists were worried that if we talked about methane, we would frighten people. And they were already having a hard enough time convincing people of basic carbon information. They said, oh my God, if you start talking about methane, everyone's just gonna, you know, not engage in the topic. So because I was gonna talk a bit about what Astrid was talking about, but since she covered that, I would just say to add on, it's because there's so much pressure to deny climate that even, especially here in the States, it's incredibly hard to even go beyond just the basic concepts. So that's slowing us down. All right, so it's not all bad news. So here's where I've landed in this, is that we have to be fiercely independent. And that's what we are here at True Media. And we are working now with international small groups of people to create a new platform. I hear you guys are doing it too, but we're actually gonna launch a platform that's completely independent. And interestingly, funding is, you know, like for everything like this, funding is strangely hard to get. You know, even, you know, all the scientists, you know, you trying to save the world and trying to change the story is one of the hardest things to get funded because everyone who are in the philanthropy world really understands change on the ground, which I fully appreciate. So, you know, is how do you get, you know, millions of dollars to change the story machine when actually you could be putting in windmills or solar or, you know, wells or all these other things that the world needs. But, you know, coming from Hollywood, everyone always thinks we're really well funded, which is, you know, not the case. Hollywood meaning the studios and the streamers and all that, you know, do something like The Screen, which is they do a few stories here and there, but they're absolutely not interested in this, right? They have no interest. It doesn't make them the money. My argument is if they actually advertised as much for our films as their other blockbusters, we'd get as much audience. One of the metrics for some of my movies, we had some of the biggest attendance ever in a weekend on our first weekend ever. And I got a call from Warner Brothers head saying, wow, that was amazing. But after that weekend, they didn't advertise anymore. They didn't even list us in the paper. So people didn't even know we were playing. So that really blew my mind. I didn't understand why that happened. So here's what you need to do. Independent platforms has to be well-funded because you have to get around the algorithm. The algorithms are suppressing this information. You need hackers, like not hackers to do bad things, but hackers to do good things. They need to find out where and how it's being suppressed. For example, we had Green World Rising, which has the pathway forward. We put it out 6 years ago, and some people in the middle of the country can't even see our website. I've had phone calls that said, hey, you know, I've heard of this website, it's not coming up. So there's that happening. The other thing one should do is explain it differently. And I found with Ice on Fire, we got a lot of traction. And what's working in terms of messaging is the drawdown message, is the carbon up, carbon down. So why is that interesting? I mean, yes, climate is complex. It's changing all the time. We know that. However, overall, in all the nuances of climate, it's carbon up, carbon down. We live within a band of carbon in the atmosphere that wavers, but obviously it's shooting way beyond its frame. So people don't quite get that. We've been talking about greenhouse gas emissions. We've been talking a lot about emissions, but we don't really talk about how it comes down again. We've only been talking about how it goes up. And so this idea that it's a cycle, which of course we're taught in school, but that hasn't been this at the head of the spear of the climate messaging. What I'm finding with Ice on Fire is that it's gotten a lot of traction because we've explained the cycle a little better. I mean, more, not better. Let's not say better. Let's just say that was our focus. So for example, why is that important? Because that gives people something to do. Because when you're just talking about emissions, you're talking about, you know, governmental level, you know, electricity grids, they're dealing with coal or, you know, nukes or whatever it is, you know, hopefully renewables. But when you're talking about carbon sequestration and pulling it out of the sky, you're talking about tree planting, which a lot of people can get. You're talking about changing the way we grow food, organic farming, soil, biochar, kelp planting. I mean, you're talking now about, you're gauging a lot more people. And so that's, I think, where we need to head in terms of the messaging, because you really engage a lot of people with the drawdown message. Now, whether you want to call it drawdown or whatever else, it doesn't matter, but it's the idea that, yes, we can actually pull it out of the sky and put it back in the ground. Nature does it, and we really need to focus on that. Of course, now we focus in Ice on Fire on the direct air capture machines made out of existing parts. Yes, tech has a role to play. There's also, I know, a lot of biomimetic, new visionary innovations where you're passively pulling carbon out of the sky. So that's kind of like, I explain it to people, not you don't need to explain it, but other people, that it's like bailing out a sinking ship with buckets. You got to just get it out of the sky. You got legacy carbon and current carbon. All right, so platforms. So we've actually also built something called Catching Carbon to disrupt also the flow of money. So a lot of people are like, well, we have to wait to change policy, which absolutely we have to change policy. We have to work on that every day. But what happens if the world decided to circumvent policy and just pay for it in microtransactions? So for example, catchingcarbon.org is an experiment. We launched it just before COVID. And so I haven't been advertising that, but it's a question. You know, what happens if the world put in 100 DAC machines, you know, acres and acres of kelp and all these trees, just as a symbolic gesture to say, hey, you know, we want to pay, we can save ourselves. We don't actually need to try and get around all of the policy people that are bought out by the fix, which they are. I mean, here we've done tons of other movies called We the People 2.0, where we've been on the ground in Ohio and Pennsylvania. They are ravaged by horrible, I mean, not just bad information, but their entire legislative bodies are bought by the oil industry. There are laws in America where you can't even sue the oil industry for anything. even if they killed you by accident with one of their wells, you cannot sue them. So it's bad. So you have to work around these people. They have no interest in helping. And so I would only say that given what we see with people like Greta, who emerged, and the climate strikes, and the in California, we're getting more and more towards solar. I mean, we are, I think, now 30% renewable in the state of California, and it's getting better every day. I would say, given the amount of disinformation and money and entrenched politicians that we're dealing with, and the story machine that has no interest in telling the story, that we've done much better than I thought. So I would say persistence, persistent platforms, funding workarounds, the algorithms, getting smart people to make sure that when you put a message out, it goes out, because again, no one sees it. Young people understand this. They absolutely do. They just don't know what to do. So the drawdown message, I think, is incredibly important. And last but not least, we're working on something called regeneration. So we can fix everything that we've harmed. There are innovators and scientists that know what to do again. So we're working on within the platform, a giant push to talk about how to heal all things, land, ocean, air. And we'll be working on that in the next couple of years. So hopefully we can do it in collaboration with international networks and UNESCO and the UN. And usually whatever we do, the UN and the EU and everyone picks it up and puts it around. But now we, as you say, we all have to work together because there's not a lot of time. And we, this regeneration project actually came to me. They said, let's do a big Netflix series. I said, you know what? Let's not do that. We don't need that. We need to just put it out on a platform for free on the internet. Just do this. So now we're trying to find, although it's going to take quite a lot of, it's a large budget to do it, but you need it. Again, I mean, I feel bad, but it's like, you know, do we want to change the story machine or not? So that's what I have to say from my corner of the world.
When you go into the making the film, no? How do you verify and the information that's going to be used? I mean, how do you make sure that it's relevant, it's important, and it's accurate?
Well, we basically work with scientists, and we work with, we've been in the space for a while, I mean, 20 years. So what we've learned, and this is another idea I think that works, is the idea of persistence. So we're aware of the Union of Concerned Scientists, we're aware of NOAA, we're aware of NASA, we're aware of, you know, the some of the scientists that have a bigger names in the business, you know, like James Hansen and again, Michael Mann. And then, you know, so we work with institutions, right? That for a long time. So one can see truth is very persistent. And that's the other thing. We really do have truth on our side here. And it really can't hold back the reality of things. And I know I'm straying question, but basically that's how we know what to do, because we do listen to the science and we have relationships with them and rely on them. And also we go to where things are actually happening. Like for, you know, with Ice on Fire, we went to see where they measure the CO2 up in the Rocky Mountains. And it was funny because I don't think I've ever seen that anywhere else. And it also to fault my own storytelling, why didn't I do that sooner? Because I thought it was very effective to see that there's actually a way that this is measured, and it's measured all over the world every week. So, you know, things like that are what we do. We go and actually see it with our own eyes rather than rely on intermediaries. And that's something, you know, we do not rely on intermediaries. But I would back to just quickly, I would like to say with truth and persistence, you know, it takes a lot of money to maintain a falsehood. And also, I think with COVID-19, we are seeing Mother Nature or wherever it came from, you know, whatever. But the point is, this is a natural phenomenon that cannot be denied, even though they're doing a very good job trying to deny it with their numbers or whatever is going on, it's just going to make itself known. And so the problem with climate is we know that when it makes itself known, it might be a little too late. So that's the biggest problem with climate. Yeah. But on our side, we just have to be persistent and depend on science.
Good. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Leila.